Well, I had no idea what Herbina was going to say, but it is interesting that she talks about us growing up together. I was like 25, and that's very similar to my character Shelley in the book. She's 25, but naive, and in a culture that she doesn't know. And there also is a character, Letty, in there, who's a teenager, who also wants to be a doctor. And how Shelley learns from the Salvadoran teenage girl. Something that surprised me is the help I got from unexpected places. And I just want to recognize that. And in a few minutes, I'm going to read you the dedication and also the acknowledgments of people. Novels actually have several themes, at least mine does. Sometimes a theme emerges that the author wasn't conscious of. A theme that came into my story inadvertently is, we can choose family. It makes perfect sense, though, because I had a great-grandfather that I dearly loved, when in truth, he was no relation. My great-grandmother had already been married 3 or 4 times, and she wasn't about to marry another man. She didn't care how much she loved him. In fact, her husband lived in one of the cabins that the two men together built, and they remained best friends for their entire lives. Like Shelley, my protagonist, I only found out this lie when I was in my 20s. And also, like her, it made no difference once I accepted this truth. Geraldina is my ex-husband's sister, but she will always be my little sister. Her mother will always be my second mother, and I will always be close to that family. Minus my ex, of course. This family will always be part of my family. So that was one of the things in the novel that I didn't even realize were there. It just came out because it's a part of who I am. Many of you know that I dedicated the book to my husband, and I will read that dedication shortly. But I also must mention that the stories told to me by Geraldina and her mother, Julia, were very important, and in truth, I could not have written such a rich story without their sharing their lives with me. Julia, is there any chance you would stand up? No. Thank you. I love this woman like a mother. She was there for me when I was sick. I got food poisoning several times in New Orleans. Food poisoning is a big problem. I don't know why, but she nursed me back to health many times. And she was also there for me when I was sad or upset. And she always had a story to tell me to make me feel better. Thank you, Julia, for making me a better person and a better writer. I love you very much. I promise I'm going to read from the book in just a minute, but there is something else I want to mention. Yesterday, someone asked me, why would a Mexican or other Latino be interested in a story about Salvador? Well, my blood started pumping and through my veins twice as fast, and I felt like I was burning up. For those of you who don't know it, most Latinos believe I have Latin American blood. I believe I have Latin American blood. I even did a past life regression in which I was an orphan in Latin America saying goodbye to my father who was a priest. My mother has Spanish gypsy blood, so maybe that is why my blood boils with so much passion. When I told a dear friend of mine about my Spanish gypsy blood, she exclaimed, oh, you got all the gypsy blood in your family. Anyway, I finally calmed myself down enough to tell this person why a Mexican or other Latin would be interested in this story. And actually, it was a very good question. Basically, this is a Latin American story. Yes, this particular story takes place in El Salvador. But similar events happen in Argentina, Venezuela, Honduras, Guatemala, and Chile. This is happening right now in Mexico. They all speak the same language, of course. And yes, they are different, different parts of their language from the Indian language, or Salvadorans, they like to make up words. So they, they have a lot of different words in their language. But also Africans, Asians, and Arabs have a similar history. It's kind of a third world story. And maybe even going, if you go back to the beginnings of all countries, maybe there are similar stories there. This novel is about women. It's about journalists. It's about family and struggle and life. This is a novel about the human condition, which is, of course, a universal theme. Finally, I want to talk about why I wrote this novel, who inspired me. And I'm going to read that in a minute about Salvadorans. Salvadorans inspired me because they didn't let the war tear their family apart. Though in many ways, I was as naive as Shelley is, probably more naive, actually. And I idealized Salvadorans, who seemed so different from me and my people. The person who most influenced me was the poet Luca Dalton. His writing was so full of love for the Salvadoran people that he made me feel that love too. I wish I could spend a day reading you his poems, but the truth is that the poems are really good in English translation, but they are amazing in Spanish. So I will begin by reading Roque Dalton's love poem. It's from the prologue, Cuba, 1962. Okay, I'll go ahead and read that, then I'll read the dedication and gratitude section, because, if you could hear this in Spanish, it's amazing, but this is a very good translation. It's hard to translate something so Salvadoran. It's Nine Love Poems by Roque Dalton, translated by Luis Gonzalo Serrano. The ones who widened the Panama Canal and were put on the silver roll and not the gold roll. The ones who repaired the Pacific Fleet at the military bases in California. The ones who brought it in jail in Guatemala, Mexico, Honduras, Nicaragua. For being thieves, smugglers, scammers. For being hungry, the ever suspicious ones. I bring forth this individual arrested for being a suspicious bystander with the aggravation of being Salvadorian. The ones who filled the bars and brothels of all the ports and capitals in the region. The blue cave, the panty, the happy end. The ones who grew corn in foreign jungles. The kings of the crime section. The ones who no one ever knows where they're from. The best craftsmen in the world. The ones who mowed down with bullets. Who were mowed down with bullets while crossing the border. The ones who died from malaria or scorpion or snake bites in banana plantation hell. The ones who cried drunk for the national anthem under cyclones in the Pacific or snow in the north. The freeloaders, the beggars, the potheads. Salvadorian sons of bitches. The ones who barely made it back. The ones who were a bit luckier. The eternal illegals. Make all, sell all, eat all. The first to pull out a knife. The saddest, sad people in the world. My countrymen, my brothers. Roque Dalton wrote that. Okay, I'm going to read the dedication, just a little bit of the gratitude, because there's some other stuff that I want you guys to hear. I don't want to waste too much time. Dedicated to my husband, Angelo Miranda. Angelo, would you please stand up? and told me to follow my dreams. He not only was an inspiration with his words, but also in his piano practice, as long as 3 hours a day, while having more than a full-time job as a teacher, and all the while finding time for his family. So without him, this novel would not have happened. This boy will always be my nephew, and I will always be his tia Sherrie, no matter what happens.
Something they had over Americans.
But she soon realizes that the mother's name is eventually dropped anyway. Two last names can be a bit cumbersome, but four, then eight, well, it becomes impossible to continue after a generation or so. There are those who, for various reasons, chose to keep their mother's name, though, and not necessarily because they're illegitimate. My mother's name, my maiden name, is Dalton, Senor, though I don't remember her mother's last name. Dalton, yes, I thought I could see a resemblance. How wonderful! You are not Salvador. You are one of us. He gets up from his chair and motions Sherrie to stand up. He is hugging her with great vigor and is all smiles. But what on earth is he? He couldn't think. Senorita, you are related to our country's greatest resource. You are a Dalton. Granddaughter, okay, niece, yes, I believe you are the niece of Roque Dalton, our greatest poet, our hero. Senor, I love the idea as much as you, but I don't think it could be true. My grandmother, Shelley's getting confused herself now, said my grandfather, Winnell, was killed. Her mind is racing now, trying to remember the snippets of conversation between her mother and the woman Shelley had always been told was her grandmother. Her great-grandmother spent the rest of her life in a depression after the loss of her son. When her great-grandma would start to tell Shelley about Grandpa Winnell, her mother would admonish her and tell her to keep quiet about something she knew nothing about. Shelley never could understand how her mother could talk to her own flesh and blood like that. But Shelley knew the truth now. Her grandmother had given her a beautiful tin box on her deathbed. The tin box that contained a letter Winnell wrote to his sister about having a son named Roque. Yes, Shelley wanted it to be true more than anyone. She wanted to be related really to Roque. If everything she had learned was true, and it did seem to be, Roque Dalton, Salvador's most prolific and patriotic poet, was her uncle. Young lady, Senor Martinez tells her, I'm going to prove it to you. You'll see. Shelley wonders how he would know anything about her family, or why he would even care, except she does know Roque Dalton's poetry, and she knows it is some of the most beautiful poetry she's ever read, even if she doesn't understand some of it. Senor Martinez hugs Shelley again, then starts to shake hands with Mr. Gonzalez, but instead grabs him and gives him a bear hug. Then he's out the door. Shelley stands there wide-eyed with her mouth open. Chapter 18, Trust. The next day, Shelley hears a knock at the Gonzalez's door. She opens the door to see that boy again, the boy of about 10 years of age who keeps appearing when she least expects it. Shelley stares at him. He tells her, you need to come with me, but won't say where. Leti yells, who is it? Es el niño, Shelley yells. The one who keeps showing up, the mystery boy. She looks at the child. ¿Cómo te llamas? Señorita, my name is Miguel. Leti comes out from her room and looks at the boy. Hola, Miguelito. ¿Qué tal? Is everything okay? Sí, niña Leti. But they told me to come and get my Ruby Americano, my Chelly. Shelley is pacing the floor and she feels her blood pressure rise. Who are they and why won't they say where they want me to go? Está bien, Miguelito. We'll be ready in a minute. Leti tells Shelley to put on her tennis shoes and grab a jacket. Leti, I need to know where we're going and why. Some boy can't just show up and tell us someone needs to see us and we drop everything, Shelley tells her. Her face is pink with anger. Besides, I have work to do. They need me at the refugee center. Chele, este es importante. How do you know it's more important? Confía en mí, Chele. She tells her, and Chele does trust her. The next thing Chele knows, she is walking with them up the mountain behind the houses. She decides to enjoy the walk, the air, and the exercise. It's been years since she hiked a mountain, so she is enjoying that sense of getting deeper into the woods, how the light changes, how it gets darker the further you go in, and how the smell of the earth and trees gets into your nostrils. Although she is still wondering where they are going and what they are going to do at the top of the mountain. Miguelito and Leti are talking quietly, but Shelley is lost in her own world. She wonders why they're not following a trail. Miguelito seems to have them walking so as not to make a trail. Close to the top of the mountain, they come to a camp of some sort. Most of the people there are young. Shelley can tell by their old, ill-fitting clothes that they are poor, campesinos. A woman in fatigues approaches them, smiling. She grabs Shelley's hand. Hola, soy comandante Ana. Yo soy Shelley. Ana gives Shelley a hug. Hola, compañero, she says to Letty, and Shelley realizes that they know each other. Ana takes them around and introduces Shelley. The kids come up to Letty and hug her, then very shyly hug Shelley too. They don't seem surprised or nervous if there's a gringa in their midst. As Ana tells Shelley the names of these kids, Letty explains that they are their nombres de guerra. No one uses their real names here. From among all these brown-skinned people, out walks a handsome, blue-eyed, smiling gringo with beautiful, wild, dirty blonde hair. Ana says, this is Comandante Carlos. Shelley gasps and gulps and finally manages to get her hand up. Hola, soy Shelley. Shelley now understands the fascination people have with blue eyes. They reflect your image back to you, which makes you feel like a person knows you and is totally focused on you. We'll have to find a name for you before you come back again. It's a pleasure to finally meet you. What do you mean, finally? Lori got word to me that you were coming, and that you had finally arrived. How? How did she do that? Oh, we have our ways, Carlos answers. Shelley looks at him, stunned. As Carlos shows her around the camp, Letty goes off with Ana. Shelley cannot understand why Letty never mentioned her knowledge of the guerrillas and her agreement with their politics. Carlos introduces Shelley to some of the boys, as young as Miguelito, some even younger. They are hiding their faces, though their eyes smile at her. How bad could life be in this country for children to be fighting here instead of out playing, Shelley wonders. Carlos tells her, most of them lost their parents in the war. They had no place to go. We tried to find some kind of useful work for them, because we all must do something to earn our right to be here. ¿Y usted, Carlos? ¿Qué hace usted aquí? Shelley asks, suddenly embarrassed. Not that she's speaking Spanish to this American, but she dared to ask him what he does here to earn his keep. She realizes that she had been answering his English with Spanish. Carlos doesn't answer her question. Shelley wipes her face with her skirt as the guard opens the door. She follows him quietly back to the stairs. As she listens to the moans and cries, she hears someone say, tell Carlos thank you for us. As soon as Shelley gets outside, she runs over to some bushes. Her entire breakfast comes out onto the ground. Eggs, beans, tortillas, and orange juice. She turns around and one of the women vendors hands her a bottle of water and a rag, probably a piece of worn-out dress. As the woman turns around, Shelley says, Señora, su dinero. No te preocupes, niña. Cuídate, ¿oís? She pushes the money back at Shelley. I wish I didn't have to worry about anything, but yes, I will take care of myself to the best of my ability.
Yes, there's a lot of things in here that are
from my experiences. If you read the part where she goes to the hospital for the children, the parents had to go back to the countryside, but the children were too sick, and she was crying her eyes out, that actually happened to me. I remember I started crying and I could not stop for like half an hour. I was hyperventilating and I was so sad for me. The other part of the story is about children and orphans. This is my baby right here. I never had a kid, although I have many kids in my life that I love very much. And as a teacher, I meet a lot of kids, especially Angela's five students. And I get very close to a lot of kids. And also my nephew, Grayson, Glenn's son, he's at Cal Poly now. You guys are great. Going to wave your hands so they know. That's Grayson, Glenn. Glenn is Angela's brother, Grayson's my sister in law, his wife. Anyway, is there any other surprises? Olivia's here. Wave to everyone, Olivia. She's Mexican. She's writing an amazing story also. And it takes place in a similar time period. So I don't know, someday hopefully she and I will do a book tour together or something. Although there's pieces of my own life in here, when I went to El Salvador, I was very protected, especially by my now ex-mother-in-law, Julia. She protected me from everybody. But one time she got mad at me because Carolina was trying to teach me how to roller skate in the street, and she didn't think that a grown woman should be out there in the street trying to roller skate. So, does anyone have any questions? No? Yes.
Well, this is a comment, actually.
Okay.
You are one of the best writers I have ever seen before.
He's a little prejudiced, but he says I'm one of the best writers he's ever seen or read in his life. I don't know if he's seen too many of them. He actually asked his mother, how much did my books cost? Because he wanted to buy one for every student in his classroom. So, and that's what I hope happens. Somebody also asked me, are you going to get rich? And I'm like, well, so far I've only spent money. I haven't earned any. And I've spent more since then. But my dream is for everyone in the world to read the story, because this is a story of people who struggled and they survived, and they're here today to tell their story. And the Salvadoran people, they taught me how to live and how to love. And that's what they're all about, living and loving and just trying to be the best they could be. And that's how Geraldina became a doctor today, because she kept fighting and fighting to get through it. And in New Orleans, she was going to the speakers at the different tables about college, and they're saying, oh no, why don't you go be a nurse? And she's like, because I don't want to be a nurse, I want to be a doctor. And those are the kind of things she put up with all the time, and I think she had to take the test a couple times to get into medical school, but she did it all because she's Salvadoran, and that's what Salvadorans do. Do we have time to hear more music?
Yes.
Yes? Anybody know what have the time? I purposely left my watch at home.
Yeah,
what time is it?
3:15.
You want
to play
one? Okay. A bit more. Okay. Yeah, I got to. All right, and I can sign books. The books are $10. If you want a Kindle book, you should be able to buy it on Amazon for $2.99. It's been on sale for a couple of weeks, so I'm confused that somebody said that it's not on sale yet, so I'm not sure what's going on there. Okay. This is all new to me. I never did this before, and I have no idea how hard it was. Probably if I knew how hard it was, I wouldn't have done it. So it's good that I didn't know. Especially when you self-publish. There's no one there to tell you anything. But there's lots of people there.